जय श्री राम। वेलकम टू माय वीडियो सीरीज ऑन स्पिरिचुअल मैटर्स, स्पेशली फ्रॉम द स्टैंड पॉइंट ऑफ हिंदूज एंड हिंदुइज्म। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी क्लैरिफाई दैट द वर्ड हिंदू इज नॉट फाउंड इन संस्कृत। इट इज टू द बेस्ट ऑफ माय नॉलेज एंड बिलीफ एज ए पर्शियन वर्ड describing the people living on the eastern banks of eastern side of the river Sindhu. Sindhu has become Hindu, Hindu has become India, and so it went on. The the religion or whatever is practiced by the people living in India is Sanatana Dharma, that means ancient righteous way of living. This is what is practiced in India by the so-called Hindus. Now there are a variety of questions about Hinduism, and where does Hinduism get defined? Really there is no definition of Hinduism except the dharma. The question many times asked of Hindus, especially by the people of other religions and other faiths, is this: what is your religion? From the dominant religions, especially the organized religions like Christianity, Islam and Judaism, they question a religion: who is your prophet, and what is the book that defines Hinduism, your way of life? Why there are so many gods? So all these things I would like to address one by one. In this present video, I would like to address about the topic of what is the book of Hinduism. And these, I am also going to talk about the topics or the subjects which are not touched upon by all the people that come on the TV and talk about the religion and dharma, as also the people who congregate in large gatherings across India and give discourses to general public. To my chagrin and dismay, I find that these people are not addressing the real crux of the issue, or the real aspects of our religion, our way of life. These people are just cutting it because there are controversial topics around. Hinduism, yes, there are many books, and those books are sometimes contradictory to the uninitiated and untrained. If you really delve deep into these books, you will find that there is really no contradiction. Only thing is, the understanding problem is there, because the time at which it was written and the time at which we are reading, the general values have changed. The way of life changed, the meaning of the words has changed. Therefore, there is confusion, but for people who delve really deep, there is no confusion. In this book, there is a popular concept, misconcept, that Bhagavad Gita is the book of Hinduism. Not really. Bhagavad Gita is in itself not an independent book. It is part of Mahabharata. Mahabharata has 18 parvas, 18 major books. And out of 18 major books, it comes in the 6th parva, Bhishma parva, before the Mahabharata war begins. It was a dialogue between Lord Krishna and Arjuna. When Arjuna became distressed and discouraged at the war, because he has to fight his own cousins, his grandfather, his uncle, his father-in-law, all are relatives. When he looks at them, all are relatives, and he thinks that what is the purpose gained by killing my relatives for the sake of money or the kingdom? At that time, Krishna tells him Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita, as many people think, is not about the entire Hindu dharma. When you really boil the Bhagavad Gita, the quintessence you get is, do your duty. That is what Lord Krishna enunciated to Krishna Arjuna. Do your duty. You are a warrior. you are born in Kshatriya caste. For Kshatriya caste people, war is the ultimate dharma, fighting in battle without showing the back. And that is your dharma. You do your duty, that is your duty, and you do your duty. That is all that Lord Krishna tells when you really take the essence out of Bhagavad Gita. So it's not the entire book of Hindus. It is very well written. There are many hidden truths and gems are there in it. But it really needs somebody who can delve deep into it. Second misconception about Gita is, Gita has some hidden meaning. Not really. See, Bhagavad Gita, there are about 745 slokas originally. Now what is available is about 700 to 710 slokas are available in the popular books that are printed. These are all elaborated inside Mahabharata itself. These are multiple places that all through the Mahabharata, these slokas are taken and added, more slokas are added. The 700 are elaborated many times in many parvas. Ashwamedha parva, it is elaborated. Aranya parva, it is elaborated. Anushasanika parva, it is elaborated. So there is the hidden, there is nothing hidden. It is all in the Mahabharata. What is not explained here is explained elsewhere in Mahabharata. If you read it, you will understand the Bhagavad Gita very well. You don't have to read the research thesis of somebody else, because they call it Bhashyam. You don't have to read. It is already there in the Mahabharata. This is something that's not told by anybody, to my knowledge. And how many slokas are in this that Lord Krishna spoke? This is the sloka that is already given in Mahabharata, in Bhishma Parva, in the 43rd chapter. Shatshatani Sarvimshani Shlokanam Prahakeshava. That is, Krishna has told 620. Shatshatani, 600, Savimshani, plus 20, 620 slokas are spoken by Lord Krishna. Arjuna Sapta Panchashat. Arjuna has spoken Sapta, 7, Panchashat, 50. 57 slokas are spoken by Lord Krishna. Lord Arjuna. Lord Krishna spoke 620, Arjuna spoke 57. Sapta Shashtintu Sanjaya. The character Sanjaya spoke Sapta Shashtintu, Shashti, 60 plus 7, 67 slokas were spoken by Sanjaya. And Dhritarashtra Slokam Ekam Gitaya Manamuchyate. Dhritarashtra spoke one sloka. Put together, there are 745 slokas as narrated by Vyasa himself, out of which about 710 slokas are printed in Gita Press, Bhagavad Gita book. And that is what is most popularly available. That means we have lost around 35 slokas what they have spoken. And cynics say, how can this much Bhagavad Gita be spoken between the two armies ready to battle? And how much time it takes? You know, I recite Bhagavad Gita on every 11th phase of Moon Ekadashi. It takes me hardly 45 minutes. Out of this, the 67 slokas spoken by Sanjaya were not spoken there. One sloka spoken by Dhritarashtra was not spoken there. Then it is only 620 plus 67, that is 687 slokas were spoken between two people, two highly knowledgeable people. Arjuna himself was a scholar in Vedas. Krishna was a scholar in Vedas. Arjuna did not need as much time as we need to understand, because we are not initiated into Vedas. So it can be spoken very well within 45-50 minutes. And they did not begin battle yet. Even though the clarion call was given, the welks were blown, sounded, they still waited. They did not begin the war. And is there really any benefit from reciting Bhagavad Gita? There is a detailed discussion in Varaha Purana about the results that you can obtain by reciting Bhagavad Gita every day. In Bharatam itself, Mahabharata itself, Vyasa has recorded the results or the consequences or the benefits of reciting Bhagavad Gita. This is what he said. Gita su Gita kartavya kimanye shastra sangrahai ya swayam padmanabhasya mukhapadmat vinishruta. This has been spoken directly from God's mouth itself. Reciting is a good duty. It tells you the duty. Sarva Shastra Mayi Gita, Sarva Deva Mayo Hari, Sarva Stirtha Mayi Ganga, Sarva Veda Mayo Manoho. Here Vyasa has answered, which is the book for Hindus. Sarva Shastra Mayi Gita. Gita contains the essence of all Shastras. Sarva Deva Mayo Hari. All gods are embedded in Sri Hari, Lord Vishnu. Sarvatirtha Mayi Ganga, the sacred waters of all sacred rivers are within the waters of Ganga. And Sarva Veda Mayo Manoho, everybody says that Vedas are the real guiding beacons for Hindus, and they are the religious books. But Vedas are extensive. No one person can really, in these days, memorize them and practice them. So that is why Manu has given a book to all of us, Manu Smriti. And that contains all the Vedas, the essence of all Vedas is contained in Manu Smriti. Of course, the late Kashiram of Uttar Pradesh started denigrating and denouncing Manusmriti, and he said all those people who follow Manusmriti or Manuvadis have to be boycotted. Something like that he was propagating. Not exact words, I do not remember his exact words, but this is something he has been denigrating Manusmriti as Manuvada, and people who follow Manu are as bad people. But if one does not believe Manusmriti, he is not a Hindu. Simple as that. All aspects of Hinduism are there in Manusmriti. It is an equivalent book to Bible and Quran. Whatever results you get by reading from Bible and Quran, the same thing can be obtained by reading Manusmriti. So Hindus, the real book for you is Manusmriti. You should take as much offense as a Christian takes when you denigrate Bible, or as much offense as a Muslim takes when a Quran is denigrated. Hindus should react in the same manner that Manusmriti is denigrated. So in this I am telling you that what nobody else has been telling you in the discourses, either on TV or in public, the book for Hindus and Hinduism as it stands today is Manusmriti. The person who does not accept Manusmriti as his book is not a Hindu. Simple as that. Jai Sri Ram. May Lord Rama bless all of you.